Welcome, sir. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you for having me on.
Well, thank you for coming. I tell you, it is quite a surprise to interview an acting Deputy Secretary of Labor, and congratulations to you for all the hard work that you do.
Thank you very much.
Now, tell us, how did you come to be the acting secretary?
Well, it's very simple. I was the deputy secretary, and then my boss left back in January. And so I just ascended to the secretary position and had the opportunity to do things like radio interviews. And it's really been a lot of fun and a big challenge.
I've been following your work, especially, you know, since January when you took over this job. I know that you're talking a lot about community colleges, and that's something that I have a big interest in. Explain to us the type of technology that you're expecting to come out of that.
Well, the Labor Department has been investing $2 billion over 4 years in a community college program that President Obama negotiated with Congress. The idea is to bring employers and community colleges together to create programs that will train U.S. workers for the jobs that are available in their communities right now and for jobs that are going to last into the future. So we've helped to really transform community colleges across the United States by bringing them more closely into the economic development, regional planning, and into working directly with employers so that the programs that they have result in jobs for their students.
Well, jobs have certainly been the mantra not only for the last 4 years, but in the year coming into that. So tell us, like last month in May, the job numbers were seen as pretty positive.
They were, I would say, moderate, solid but moderate. So we created 175,000 jobs in May. The economy overall did. That's about been the average over the last 12 months. The private sector created 178,000 jobs. So we've had 39 consecutive months of private sector job growth that have added almost 7 million jobs to the economy. Now, the unemployment rate did tick up a tenth from 7.5% to 7.6%, but that's because 420,000 workers entered the labor market, about half of them people who had been unemployed and had given up hope and had quit looking for jobs. They came back into the labor market and are looking for work again. To me, that's a sign that workers have a lot of confidence that the economy is coming back, that it's growing, that jobs are going to be created. We saw similar numbers on consumer confidence. The consumers are more confident. That's very important for our economy. So I'd say it's going well, but we could be doing a lot better. We could be creating thousands more jobs. For example, passing this comprehensive immigration reform bill will help our economy to grow dramatically. It'll pump $200 billion a year into our economy, help our gross domestic product to grow. It'll drive down our budget deficit. And let me just tell you, it'll help to shore up our Social Security and Medicare trust funds.
Well, how's it going to do all this? Because, you know, it's wonderful when we sit around and talk about somewhere less than 200,000 jobs in a month is a big increase for the United States of America and helping our gross domestic product. But when we look back now, if we are going to basically over the course of a decade either legalize or allow to immigrate almost the population of Canada, when we're celebrating less than 200,000 jobs growth in a month, how is that going to work? I don't understand how the more people we get in an unemployment situation and legalizing the ones that are already here, that helps us.
Well, two ways that's going to work. First is for the undocumented who are already here. There are 11 million. Most of them are already working, but many of them are not yet paying taxes, and they're not contributing to our economy in that way. So if you pass this bill, 3 million more people will be paying income taxes, Social Security, and Medicare taxes. That will help us. It will also help us that employers won't be able to exploit the undocumented workers anymore because we'll both bring those folks out of the shadow and stiffen penalties and make it a lot tougher on employers who are cheating their competitors by hiring undocumented workers, driving down their wages, giving them terrible working conditions, and getting a price advantage over their competitors. So that's one way it'll help the economy. A second way is there are tens of thousands of people who come to the United States, they study in our universities and colleges, or they try to come here to invest their money. They get a degree, a PhD, and master's in a STEM field, science, technology, engineering, math. And then because our system is so broken, we send them home. So they go home to their home country and start a business there and compete against the United States rather than staying here in the United States and helping to create jobs. So the president's proposal, and it's in the bill that's in Congress right now, would staple a green card to any STEM master's degree or PhD, so these highly qualified students stay here and help to create jobs in the U.S. We'll also bring in, the bill would bring in a lot of entrepreneurs who are marshaling capital from overseas and here in the U.S. to create businesses. Immigrants are a huge part of the economic growth story. They create...
Sure. I mean, no, and I don't mean to interrupt you, Mr. Secretary,
sure,
and I certainly agree with you on that, but our problem doesn't seem to be, that's not our major problem, these STEM people, as you're pointing out. Our major problem seems to be the illegal workers that are here in the United States of America, and I think that that is what is concerning all the people that are against the bill and for the bill, and the more you hear it. We had a recent poll that came out yesterday, actually, in Florida that said that a great majority of people in the state of Florida, voters, would support immigration reform. The problem is that that poll was seven or eight questions long, and this bill is 1,000 pages long. Why does that have to be? Because I think that's why we can't understand what's in it, especially coming on the stems of Obamacare that has been such a surprise to people such as myself that realized I didn't know I was driving a Cadillac healthcare plan. I thought that was the plan that our family had chosen for ourselves.
All right, well, let me just say, you're not going to get me to defend the long-windedness of politicians here in Washington. I'm not going to do that. But let me tell you how this is going to help to solve the problem that people in Florida are concerned about. First thing is an earned path to citizenship. Folks are not going to get amnesty. They're going to have to work very, very, very hard to get from where they are into citizenship. They're going to have to pay their back taxes, pay a penalty. They're going to have to learn English. They're going to have to go through background checks. This is going to be tough, and as you said, it's going to take up to 13 years under the existing bill. But we also have to focus on border security, strengthening border security. We now have the largest number of boots on the ground on our southern border that we've ever had, 21,000 Border Patrol agents. That's an all-time record under President Obama. As a consequence of that, border apprehensions are down 80% since 2000. They're down 50% since 2008. We're getting more drugs, more money, more weapons captured at the border. So increasing border security is an important priority in this bill and to President Obama. The bill would add another $8 billion in border security investments. But we also have to strengthen...
But even the $8 billion, again, excuse me, because I'm trying to understand. And I mean, obviously, I love America just as you do, and I want something wonderful to happen in immigration reform. But it doesn't seem as though this completely secures our border. In fact, the language that comes in and out of the bill and what was discussed on Monday in the Senate seems to shut down the fact that we don't necessarily want to secure our border 100% or even 99% before we institute legalizing people that are already here. That doesn't seem to make sense to me.
Well, it is going to... Well, we are going to strengthen up the border security with that big investment of additional money and the significant resources we've already got there. But at the end of the day, we're not going to be able to do it simply with an investment in border security. We also have to do two other things. One is we've got to crack down on employers who are employing undocumented workers. They have to play by the rules or they have to be held accountable. This bill does that. It uses the national E-Verify system, which makes sure you can know whether or not a worker is in violation of law, and it significantly increases penalties for employers who violate the law. But at the same time, we've got to fix the system whereby people come into the country legally. We've got to make it easier for people who are trying to get into the United States to try to create jobs, to try to reunite with their families, to get in by increasing numbers and making the system that is now broken easier to use, because a lot of folks just get frustrated. They give up and maybe they do something that they shouldn't do. So those things all taken together will make a big improvement for the United States, and it will reduce the inflow of undocumented into the United States over time, and it will help to deal with our economic problems and help us to create jobs.
I certainly agree with you. I just don't think 1,000 pages is what does it. You and I are having this discussion. Perhaps we should have been sitting in on these meetings and we could have cut to the chase. Please explain to me, sir, what is a W visa?
Oh, well, the W visa program was agreed to in negotiations between the labor movement and the business community. It is a non-immigrant visa program that's proposed in this bill that would bring a small number of workers in each year to be able to do selected occupations in the United States. There are existing non-immigrant visa programs that we have. It's an alphabet soup, the H-2B program, the H-1B program, the H-2A program. This would be a program that would be added to those programs, but it's a very small program. And it's the product of a bipartisan negotiation and an effort by the labor movement, the business community, to come to an agreement so that we can pass immigration reform.
Well, as I understand it, this is kind of an unskilled guest worker program. Is that correct?
The W visa program would be for lesser skilled workers, while the H-1B visa program is a program that's for higher skilled workers, mostly in the technology industry. That's right.
Well, the unskilled workers, if they can come in up to the point of 200,000 workers a year, that's something that your Labor Department and, you know, everybody else has been celebrating. We didn't even hit that with new jobs in 1 month when we're in the middle of this recovery. Again, I guess that I'm just too dense to understand it. I also wanted to ask you about casual, sporadic, irregular, or intermittent employment opportunities as defined by the acting Secretary of State. That would mean that people could still hire illegal aliens to do such thing as farm work, doesn't it?
Well, I'm not sure it means that. Let me go back on the W program, though. And the number in the bill as it stands right now is not 200,000. In the first year, it would only be 20,000, is my understanding. But it's part of a larger picture of how we assure that U.S. workers have a fair shot at jobs, and employers are going to have to recruit U.S. workers first, and that's a very important thing, but also to make sure that employers and industries that have trouble finding U.S. workers have an opportunity to operate by getting the workers that they need. This is a very small part of the bill. The biggest, most important parts of the bill, though, I think, are the border security sections of the bill, the earned pathway to citizenship, fixing the broken legal immigration system, and cracking down on employers that are violating the law. If we have these small non-immigrant programs, we can help to accomplish that latter result and get folks to hire those immigrants who are here legally, and also to hire U.S. workers, most importantly, to do the work that they need to get done.
I'm just still unclear of how it's all going to work. But the other thing that concerns me, you know, besides the 1,000 pages, is that this bill allows for the Department of Homeland Security. You know, a lot of these things that people are finding, especially conservatives' fault with the Obama administration, is so much emphasis and so much responsibility is given back not only to Congress, but to individual secretaries and the so-called czars within the Obama administration, such as this particular clause that allows the Department of Homeland Security to appoint legal counsel for illegal aliens to fight deportation at taxpayers' expense. That's on page 583. Can you explain? I mean, are you worried about that, especially when you're the person that has to report on the economy all the time?
Well, I'm actually not worried about it. Let me just say, I've been in the Obama administration since right at the beginning, and I can tell you I've never met a czar. I just never seen that. It's a pretty typical function of Congress to delegate the execution of laws to executive agencies like the agency that I run, the Labor Department. But we do it, let me just tell you, under very close scrutiny from Congress. They have a lot of control over the money that we spend. They have control over the functions we undertake. We're in a constant dialogue with them about whether we are actually accomplishing what they have said they want us to accomplish. So they're not throwing it down to us and then throwing their hands in the air. We're working very closely with them. It's going to be our job to make sure that this bill is carried out in an appropriate way, consistent with what Congress wants us to accomplish.
Well, God bless you, and thank you so much, because when we look at all the things that are happening, especially you must be even more hopping mad than most Americans are at the IRS and the black eye that those guys have given you while they were being closely scrutinized and funded by Congress. But we certainly do appreciate you, sir. Thank you so much for taking the time out to be on our humble radio station here on Talk Radio 600 WBOB, and we wish you a very wonderful day as far as you move through the mess, I guess, it's in front of us with this immigration bill. I don't see a whole bunch of hope for it passing the House, but we appreciate you coming on.
Cindy, I really appreciate you having me on. Thanks.
Thanks. Have a great day. You're listening to Talk Radio 600 WBOB. This is the Cindy Graves Show. We're going to come back with more of your calls at 904-854-1320, and thank you for listening.